Hello, and welcome to East West's Quantum Leap Raw Library. I'm David Earle, and I'll be your host as we explore this cornucopia of instruments from all around the world. This library is one of the most extensively and meticulously sampled libraries ever. It's got 13 gigabytes of samples from Africa, the Americas, the Middle East, the Far East, Europe, and even Australia. The instruments were recorded with a phase-aligned 8-mic setup going into an API console, so the sound quality is really gorgeous. They were using all kinds of really high-caliber, large diaphragm and small diaphragm microphones. With the addition of the SSL effect suite, which is now built into the Play Engine, the sounds are even more malleable, and they'll fit into any track. Whether it's a movie soundtrack or a pop song, Raw adds a level of expression and human emotion that takes any production over the top. Now, enough talk, let's just get exploring this instrument. Like other Play libraries, we have three main windows to look at. We've got the mixer window, we have the player window, and then we have the browser. So in the browser, if we look at the Raw library, we have Africa, Americas, Europe, Far East, India, and Middle East. So everything's organized by continent, basically, an area of the world, I should say. In Africa, we have bells, drums, pit percussion, plucked shakers, and in all of the other libraries, you'll notice that they have percussion plucked in wind, and then sometimes they'll have a bowed, but they're all organized pretty much the same way. Now, when we get down to the instruments, you'll note that some of them are ensembles and some of them are solo instruments. The ensembles were recorded as an ensemble, so they tend to be very large. They sound really big and sort of magnificent. When I go into things like the Americas here and go to, say, the jaw harp, we'll see that one of them says VS, that means velocity switched. When you get into some of these libraries, you'll note that they'll have key switching, so KS is for key switching, or they'll have these programs called live. The live ones are made to be very intuitively played, so you can play them in, and all of the various ornaments and articulations that are involved with that instrument will be playable without having to go through key switching. So sometimes they'll have more than one live patch in there to give you different types of articulations when you use velocity or, you know, a controller. In the case of some of the instruments, which we'll, you know, I'll show you a couple of these instruments, they have actual performances that you can go into, and they're performed passages of that instrument. Because sometimes, you know, we're just not going to be as good as one of those professional players that's been playing one of these instruments for the past 20 years. Now, on the left-hand side, in Logic here, I have a lot of these different instruments organized by region. So I've got my African, my American, European, Far East, and Indian instruments. And I just wanted to show you a couple of these instruments and how I use them. So let's have a listen to some of these now. First of all, any decent African drum ensemble is going to have a Gankwe in it. This is one of the instruments that sort of ties down a African ensemble. Then down below that, we have a djembe ensemble. So the Gankwe is a solo instrument. The djembe ensemble was recorded as an ensemble to retain the sort of bigness of the ensemble. The gil stick is a sort of marimba-like instrument. Then we have the string instruments of Africa, like the kora. The kora is a 21-string harp that's built on top of a calabash gourd that you play with your forefinger and thumb. Really beautiful instrument, and really well rendered, and as you play it, you can hear how velocity really shapes the expression of the instrument. And then down below we have ikpiri, which is a type of shaker that's worn on the body. And I have it in this ensemble just because I think it's cool that they included this. It's a type of shaker that's very, very common in Africa, but you don't find in many libraries. Now below that, we get into the Americas. So in South America, we have the berimbau, which originally came from Africa, but is very popular in Brazilian music and is actually the centerpiece of capoeira, which is a Brazilian martial art form. And they made it very playable. They put it on the octaves of F sharp so that, and then on G sharp, you get a variation on it. Now, the berimbau is a one-string instrument that you're changing its pitch by manipulating a stone that's pulling on the string. So it's very beautifully done here so that you can very quickly and easily make a really cool little track with it. You can also hear the gourd that's on the bottom of the berimbau when you place it against your body. It makes a wah-wah sound as you pull it away from your body. Really cool. We have some standard Cuban percussion, of course, with conga, bongo, timbale. We have some interesting stuff like jaw harp, which is a cool instrument that you place against your teeth and you use the formants of your mouth to make sound. It's beautiful. Some of the more interesting instruments I've put in here to listen to just because they're the ones that I've been searching for and finally found in the raw library. Banjo is no exception. If you ever want to play Rainbow Connection. But I just think it's a beautiful banjo sample and it's so playable. Below that, we have a dobro, which is a lap guitar. Now, what I love about this instrument and the reason I wanted to show this to you is because you get a little bit of handling noise in there. You can hear the player handling the instrument, and I think that that's very unique. And it's cool to incorporate that and leave that in the library. I also put a very large reverb on it, this Dark Abbey, to give it some mystery and things like that. And there's these beautiful slides that happen on the dobro when you hit it at high velocity. The cedar flute, this is based off of a Native American Indian flute, and there's some beautiful articulations on it. And when you hit the articulations by using high velocity, it adds these ornaments at the top and bottom of the lines that adds a lot of emotion to the performance. So on solo instruments, the solo instruments always have these extended techniques and ornaments, and you'll find that in the libraries, they'll be categorized as live or key switched. If you look at the key switched libraries, if I was to load that up, you'll get all the articulations down here as key switching. But what can be more fun and more intuitive is to use the live settings, because when you use the live settings, there are no key switches that you have to worry about where to place the right ornament or technique or whatever. You don't have to worry about any of that. All you have to worry about is playing it. And I think that that's one of the things that makes RA very unique, is they made it a very playable library. All right, moving on, we get to the alp horn. This is an instrument I never thought I would see in a library. A genuine European alp horn. These are very long, long instruments that have no valves or anything. You just play it and you're using the harmonic series, much like a bugle is used in the military. The alp horn, even though it's a traditional instrument that you usually find on the sides of the Swiss Alps, they've had amazing composers write for them like Brahms, and it's really beautiful. Very well rendered frame drum. So that's a single head drum that you place on your leg and you play with your fingers. And what I love is that they also included frame drum effects where you are dragging your finger across the head of the instrument or creating little harmonic sounds. And when you add those in, it's really beautiful. The sound design is wonderful. And people who really know how to play the frame drum have really interesting ways to create sounds. Highland pipes, bagpipes, another instrument that's very hard to find in libraries and not have them sound incredibly cheesy. But with the bagpipes that are included in the RA library, they used velocity switching to create some really realistic ornaments. So those are the first bagpipes I've ever actually been able to use in a track. And below that, we have the Julian pipes, which are really special to me because when I listened to Kate Bush's Sensual World album in 1989, I always wanted to find this instrument. So that you hear a lot on albums, maybe Clannad or, like I said, Kate Bush's Sensual World. Beautiful, soaring bagpipes. We get into China, and we have the erhu. The erhu I wanted to include here to show you how legato works. So the legato setting will make it so that you can't play more than one note at a time, and it intelligently switches between the notes so that there's a seamless movement from one note to the next. It's a technology called cue legato that EastWest created back in the day, and it's really beautifully rendered here, and I think the erhu gains a lot of realism from that technique. So legato settings on certain solo instruments, definitely explore that. Then we have gamelan ensemble. I just love the tonality of this. It's untuned, so the tuning of the gamelan ensemble is very, very specific to the region of Bali. And I wanted to explain microtuning, because up here you can see that it has a Western tuning on this instrument. The instrument itself was sampled in its native tuning, though. But on other instruments, like you could take flutes or string instruments or anything like that, go up to microtuning and check out all of these tuning tables from other countries. There's even, you know, there's West African, we've got Arabic, we've got Indian, different Indian tunings. And microtunings are very important in world music because the microtuning is sort of the personality of whatever instrument or tribe happens to be playing the instrument. So the microtuning is very specific to the region that these instruments come from. And I think it's important to be able to explore these and not just use Western tuning. So I highly recommend checking that out. The taiko ensemble that's included in this from Japan, I just wanted to show that it's different in tone from other taiko ensembles that I've heard. So it's very muted and kind of thuddy, and that's actually how taikos really sound. A lot of people, when they think about the taiko ensemble, they think of these big, massive cinematic drums. And I think that the way that these were sampled was a lot more subtle and actually captures how a real taiko ensemble sounds. So if you place this up against something like storm drum, I think it's very strong. The koto. So I wanted to show you with the koto, it's just beautifully sampled and the velocity sensitivity, if you go sort of medium velocity, you get a bend. And if you hit high velocity, you get that scratch across the string, which is just beautifully done. Again, koto, something that you see in a lot of libraries, but not this deeply sampled. The dizzy is a flute that has a resonating membrane in its chamber, and it's not usually represented well. As you'll hear here, I think it sounds very realistic. So all those little ornaments are great, but mainly it's the way that they got the resonating membrane right. It's just beautiful. Really, really well done. Sarangi melody. So this I included as an example of how performances happen. So EastWest brought in these players who are the best at their craft and had them play melodies. So if you're adding something like sarangi in on one of your songs, this keeps things very realistic. To throw these in every once in a while, you get these phrases that just ooze realism and add an expressiveness to that you could never perform via MIDI. It's something that only could be played by a real player. And down we go further into India, and we've got the tambura, which is essentially, it's just the resonating, it's a string with a resonating box that usually plays behind somebody like a sitar player when they're playing classical music. But what I love about this tambura is that it has to be played like a real tambura. Normally, when you play this sample in other libraries, it's just a long droning pad. But here, you actually have to re-trigger it. And that's how a tambura is really played. So I just thought that was really cool and I wanted to include that. The bansuri is a very long, it's usually about 4 feet long, and it's a beautiful Indian flute. And I think that some of the ornaments and the way that they sampled this flute was just really well done. There are bansuris in other libraries, but I think that the way East West captured the ornaments and the additional techniques is just really well done. And we have a little bit of chiffing on the flute as we go higher velocity. Middle East section. Now, I'd never heard anything like this before. This is an entire 30-piece ensemble playing unison. See, I'm using the legato setting again. When you play these lines in legato, it just sounds amazing. It reminds me of, you know, Within You and Without You by the Beatles. Just check this out. All of those bends are being done by a velocity, really playable. And I just think it's beautiful. It's such a cool idea. And I don't hear that in any libraries either. Again, when I go down to something like the Yaeli tambour, the only reason I included this is because I know what a Yaeli tambour is, but I've never seen one in a library before done really well. Yaeli tambour is a three-string instrument that can be either plucked or bowed, and they included both. So I can pluck it, and then I can play on top of it. Again, really cool, rare, interesting instrument that you don't hear very often. And I just want to skip past the doom back to the oud. So oud is a Greek instrument, and when the oud is played, it's very important how it's being picked. And I think that when you play the oud in the raw library, you can get that kind of dig on the oud. The way that the strings behave is just, it's so realistic. I just thought that was great. And then we have a very early reed instrument called the zuma. Very evocative of the Middle East, reminds me a lot of the Passion of the Christ soundtrack from the 80s. I really love this instrument, and it's one of the first wind instruments ever made, so it's very cool. Now, that's how I like to use these instruments. Again, I'm getting a lot of help from the SSL. If you look at the SSL, every one of them that I brought up is using a little bit of SSL EQ and compression, and definitely the reverbs. The impulse responses that you get are fantastic, and none of the sounds that you heard have any external processing. There's no fab filter, no waves, no nothing. Like, this is all done internally inside the play engine, and it's just wondrous. The play engine now includes in the mixer two additional effects units, amp simulator and omicide. The amp simulator is fairly easy to understand. Basically, what you have is you have a series of amplifier impulse responses that have been recorded with different microphones. So if I go to something like a bass head and turn this on, my innocent tambura, which used to sound like this, nice long release, I can turn on the amp simulator. So that's a bass rig, but I have all of these other rigs as well. Soldano amplifiers, Mesa Boogie, Carvin, Marshall, all recorded with their different microphones, like a Sennheiser 421, an AKG D112, an RE20, a Josephson 22S, and an SM57, giving you a lot of different tonal characteristics of these amplifiers as well, which is very, very cool. Now, the really interesting plugin that they added was Omicide. So Omicide is a multi-band distortion and dynamic plugin. So you get saturation and distortion characteristics on four independent bands, similar to how you'd have like a multiband compressor where specific frequency ranges are going to be compressed differently. This is going to distort different bands in different ways. The way that it's laid out, essentially you get a noise gate, you get a couple of tonal shaping controls, you get a gain, which is going to apply how much distortion. Underneath that, you have the type of distortion that you want. If you click, you get three different categories, standard, triple X, and odd. And then down at the bottom, you have things like feedback, bias, frequency, spread, and then a little channel strip, which has volume, solo, mute, and mix. So now when I play back that innocent tambora, which used to sound like this, it sounds like this. So it gives you a lot of tone shaping capabilities. I'll come down to this Yali tambour and let's check this out. Remember that used to sound like this? And now it sounds like something alien. And last but not least, get yourself a percussive sound. Pop a little ohm side on it. And the percussion sound, which used to sound like a Doombeck, you can actually make it sound a bit more electronic. I usually really like ohm side on things that are very transient because you can use the noise gate to great effect. Have a lot of fun with this plugin. There's a lot of things going on with Omicide. If you go into the upper right, you can save these individual presets and then switch between them. You'll see that the knobs shift slightly when I select these buttons. What that's doing is it's morphing from one patch to another. So there you go. That's Omicide in a nutshell. I highly suggest getting deep inside this, look in the manual, play around with it. It's a very intuitive plugin. Just play around with the knobs a bit, and I think you'll have a lot of fun with it. So now what I'd like to do is play you a demo song that's using these instruments that was made specifically for East West, and I'll see you the next time we explore one of these great East West libraries. So take care. Ciao.